the past few years, Ricky Gervais, Stephen Merchant, and Carl Pilkington have been meeting regularly for a series of pointless conversations. Okay. This is one of them.
Testing. Is that right? Hello, and welcome to The Ricky Gervais Show. With me, Ricky Gervais, Stephen Merchant.
Hello.
And the little round-headed buffoon, that is Carl Pilkington.
All right.
Now, you probably know me from such works as The Office and Extras, Stephen being my co-writer and co-director on those things. For those people who are not so aware of Karl Pilkington, he was our producer, sort of given to us when we first started on XFM. You're thinking, well, why are we doing a podcast? It's because I'd like to be in a room with Karl Pilkington. Mm. You know, like some people go and help sort of chimps.
Do they?
Yeah.
Well, they go to the you know, the
yeah,
jungles and things.
Yeah, help out little sort of endangered
species. Dying Fossey or whatever.
Exactly,
yeah. The Dying Fossey of the Manchester scene.
Of the little bald mank world. And Karl Pilkington is an ongoing experiment for me, because I've seen him blossom from an idiot into an imbecile. And I want to see it through. Look at the way he's looking at us. Look at that. He's got a perfectly round head. And that's why I'm doing this podcast. Karl, what do you think about all this?
It's just, I mean, we are living in that sort of era now, aren't we? Like, you need to... Yeah, I listen to stuff on demand when you want it and stuff.
I know you're not a fan of the iPod in general, are you? Or any of the MP3 things, you're concerned?
I'm warm to it, but...
This is what's amazing about Karl. Even though he's talking about things like MP3 players, computers, iPods, he sounds like he was found in a glacier and thawed out. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. Sort of taught to speak.
We're a couple of high school guys who found him, and we're trying to ingratiate him in the gang, trying to pass him off as someone from the modern day.
But my thing with iPods is, now, do we need them? Do you know what I mean? We're living in that era now where we have invented most of the stuff that we need, and now we're just messing about.
They said that in 1900. Someone actually said everything that's to be invented has already been invented. They said that in 1900. And how wrong were they?
No, but what came out? At what point? What was invented in that year where they went, right, that's it now?
The 20th century. Think what happened in the 20th century.
Go on.
Well, planes.
Yeah, but is that a good thing? Planes and that. Do you need a plane, really? Wouldn't it have been better if we all stuck where we should be instead of travelling about?
War.
Why? Well, look, war's happening, isn't it? Because everyone's saying, well, now we can fly, we'll go over there.
So there were no wars prior to the invention of the aeroplane?
Not like there is today.
Right.
But what I'm saying is, the world's got smaller on it, everyone's saying that, right?
Yeah.
You know, the way I was saying to you the other day, we now go to places where we shouldn't go. People go on holiday to places where you've got to have an injection before you go there.
Yeah.
Forget it then. That's a warning. Don't
worry.
Well,
I'm with you on that. I don't want to enter a country where I have to have an injection to stop me from dying while I'm in that country. Right, I totally agree with you on that.
So what happened is, so they invented the plane and it's like, oh, let's go on holiday. And then they go, oh, they're dying now. Oh, well, you've got to invent something. Let's invent an injection. And then it's like, right, well, what else do we need to go to that place? It's a lot of faffing. So what I'm saying is...
Is that a place? A lot of faffing?
What I'm saying is, you know, Steve's travelled more than I have. You've been to, like, dangerous places.
I've been to places where you need injections, yeah.
Yeah, but why?
Because it's fascinating, isn't it? You know, don't you not believe in the idea of travel broadens the mind? You know, it makes you experience other ways of life, other ways of thinking. It just enriches you as a human being. That's the whole reason people go travelling.
Well, since the invention of the telly, you don't have to go that far to see it.
Absolutely right.
So there you go, then. The telly was the 20th century, wasn't it?
Yeah, it's pretty good.
So where would you stop, then? You'd stop making stuff now? Stop inventing stuff right now?
If we're going to invent something, right, forget, like, the traditional way of people having kids, right? The way they, you know, have it away in that.
You know, what do you mean?
No, you know, like, the way that, you know, we have kids and stuff. If it'd be good if what happened was to control it is if man and woman... Right? They sort of be born and that, they enjoy their life, they learn a lot, they live to be about 78, I think, by that point.
But
by 78, I reckon you've sort of got to that point where you go, do you know what, I've done everything I'm going to do. If you haven't bungee jumped by the time you're 78, you're not going to do it. You know what I mean? So it's kind of like...
Your hips come off.
You've done it all now.
Yeah.
And then you die, right? So say if everyone had that, they live to be 78.
Mm.
But then just as you die, you have a little baby inside you. And as you die, your life carries on.
Sorry,
how is this happening?
Sorry, are you mental?
No, but don't you think?
I mean, what? I've never heard such drivel.
You're saying that, but if Newton said it, you'd go, interesting. That's what annoys me.
I know he did, Carl. He never would. He'd never say it. That's the point.
I don't understand what you're talking about there. How was it? How is there a little baby in a 78-year-old?
No, what I'm saying is, it's like an apple where the apple grows and it's got its little baby pips in it, and the apple goes and the seeds are planted and a new one's born.
That's what happens.
But that is what reproduction is.
Yeah, but I'm saying babies aren't being born left, right, and centre. It's controlled so that as someone dies. Someone's born.
But Karl, stop. Whose responsibility is this?
If you don't want to do it, we won't do it. But
is
I'm
it
just...
supposed to be nature? Is nature got to develop humans so that we act that way? We live that way? Or is this a scientific experiment?
He said to you then, look, if you don't want to do it, we don't need to do it. Like, if you're up for it, we'll sort it out. Yeah. We can do that.
We'll have a whip round. So we can do the research.
I just think, at the end of the day, we've got to do something. And is anyone keeping an eye on this and looking at what we can do next to control the population thing? It does my head in that I've got to live in London for work and what have you. And there's loads of people here. And, you know, forget going out on a Saturday night, it's too busy. And you can't move, and they keep... I mean, what annoys me about London
So your
is,
solution is that 78-year-old women have little babies inside them, and as they slip away into death, the little babies... And how is that baby then
who
raised?
After
who
the
looks
baby?
After the baby?
Because it's a pretty good system, having a baby while you're young enough to look after that baby and make sure it lives to, reproductive age itself.
I mean, that system's been working for years.
Nature sort of sorted it out. Natural selection and evolution sort of makes that a good model.
But wait a minute, nature. Pop that on hold, because Karl Pilkington's got an idea.
Yeah.
It was just that's what it was, just an idea.
Yeah, well, it was nonsense. But thank you for it.
I mean, it was the ramblings of someone you'd find by themselves in a hospital eating flies.
This is the sort of thing you find when if they find maybe a pamphlet or a booklet written by a psychopath. You know, someone just before they went on a rampage and then turned the gun on themselves, they go through their possessions and they find a book and it's got weird drawings, women with knives in their face, and this kind of guy.
In fact, I saw a similar sort of theory written out on a wall, but it was written in shit.
Exactly. Yeah.
No, all I'm saying is, I think it's, you know, when people die normally, everyone's fed up about it, aren't they, and a bit down. But if when you pass away, you go, oh, we're going to miss Gladys or whatever, but then there's this new life brought in, it's almost like a bad news.
But you're talking about it like someone could pick this idea up and run with it. Like you've given them enough information to do it. How is this possible? Where does she get the baby from? Why does it grow? Why grow it in Gladys's belly? Why not have it in a drawer? Ready to go, just add water. I mean,
who looks after son of Gladys?
There is no theory here. It's the ramblings of a madman.
What I'm saying is, though, the body's always changing, isn't it? From caveman to now or whatever.
It's changing. Cases.
And they're always finding out more and more. Like I read the other day about how they say, do you know, like they say, people have six senses.
Yeah.
There's loads more than that. Right, and there's this one.
I was like, show me that you've got one.
No, right, and there's this one that's knocking about.
Go on.
That what it is. Say if I'm in a pub, right, and I'm just doing a crossword or whatever.
Unlikely, but go on.
And there's some woman who's walked in, right, and she's staring at me.
Yeah.
I know she's looking at me, and I look up and I look around, she's looking at me. Right. And they're saying that's a new sense that they found out from, like, you know, doing tests and what have you.
Yeah, it's rubbish.
And they're saying that's been around since like man and dinosaur was knocking about.
They've stopped.
No, they've explained it.
I think it's safe to assume that, you know, that with your perfectly round head, people are always stopping.
No, but they explained
it. You just know that there's probably going to be someone there.
They said it's from the time when like caveman was like wandering about and he'd go, hang on a minute, and he looked around, there's a dinosaur there or whatever. And
right, this is nonsense. I hate when people use the term when caveman was wandering around. Caveman and dinosaurs. Oh, they used to live together. Yeah. Oh, that's the same era. Yeah. What have you been watching? Raquel Welsh.
What do you mean?
Well, what do you mean caveman wandering knocking around with a dinosaur?
You know, the Flintstones is only partly based on fact. Dinosaurs and man did not coexist. The dinosaurs had long gone before man arrived. Extinct. Kaput. You don't believe us?
Well, you don't believe because you've seen...
Because you saw that film where they took pictures of lizards and magnified them and put them next to men in films so they looked like they were fighting.
Yeah.
No, but why couldn't that have happened?
What is the film with Raquel Welsh? A Million Years BC.
A Million Years BC or something.
A Million Years BC. Brilliant.
Yeah.
No, but...
She had a sort of woolly mammoth bikini. Fact.
But why wasn't the dinosaurs back then just like how we have... dogs now, in a way.
He's watching the Flintstones. He's thinking of the Flintstones.
Yeah.
That's what he's
thinking.
When
he puts out the saber-toothed tiger.
Yeah, and then and he mixes his concrete in a pelican.
I just think that there must have been a crossover point.
Why? Why do you say that? Why do you think there must have been?
Because if nothing was knocking about at any point, how did anything carry on?
I know. Exactly. Why didn't Hitler meet Nero? It's weird. There must have been a crossover. They must have met somewhere. They must have met at a party somewhere.
They mix in similar circles.
Yeah. They must have bumped into. I can't believe it.
Yeah, forget it.
Oh.
Well, now time for one of our regular features, monkey news.
Do the jingle.
Oh, chimpanzee that, monkey news.
What we're doing here is, right, is just giving you a bit of monkey news that's gone on, right, where a monkey's been involved in it. Good little story in that.
Yeah.
Are you familiar with the one that went into space? The first sort of thing they ever sent up there before man did it and all that. You see, this is what annoys me with it, really. Armstrong gets all the glory, but do you know who went up there before him?
A monkey.
Yeah. And what happened is they taught it what buttons to hit. At the time, it like, needed to hit them, and the way they did this was like give it bananas. It was like hit the red button, and it hit the red button, and give it a banana.
Right.
And you go right, reverse is the green one, hit the green one, and then you do that, and go there's a banana. And then you go right, hit reverse, and it go and get a banana. Right. Hit the red, so it was taking commands on like headphones.
Right, but how are they giving
it
the banana?
Is that how you learn to do
radio? How are they giving it the banana?
What do you mean? No, this is before it went. You wouldn't just go and put a monkey in it and go, there you go, get on with it. They'd sort of put him in one of them capsules that you get.
Yeah.
And with on headphones.
I don't believe this happened.
Well, I'm telling you the story now. So the monkey.
I don't think they trained it to do anything. I think they sent it up there and he put electrodes coming out of it to see what.
It wasn't any of that. They did a thing like they do. Like they can with animals. If you give something, you know, like a treat, you can teach it how to do it. It's just like a dog, isn't it?
It's called Pavlovian conditioning. However, that was to see if it would salivate or go over to a particular corner, not if it could control a spacecraft.
Next one up. The next one up. As far as the monkey's not sat there going, oh, I'm a bit under pressure, it's a rocket. All that's knowing is, I'm getting a banana if I hit that button. That's all the monkey's thinking about.
Right? They wouldn't put billions of space dollars.
But how can they be sure that it's going to press the button at the right moment?
Because it's got headphones on. It's not like willy-nilly, it's not just like pop it in there.
What's to stop it from just hitting it any old time? Because it's a monkey and it's not a human.
Because he's trained, no.
Oh, anyway, he's trained, so he's fully trained, yeah.
So what happened is anyway.
Oh, this is absolute rubbish.
They pop the monkey in there.
Yeah.
It's got its headphones on. They're going, right, hit the green one. And I think there's something there that a little banana comes out to keep the same.
No, you're making this up.
I'm not, it's the same.
There's no way that they made a spacecraft that had a banana dispenser. Right. There's no way in this world that they made a spacecraft that could go into outer space, right?
So what's
so manned by a monkey with a banana dispenser?
So you're saying that it's easy to send something up to space, but you don't believe there's a little banana machine?
Right, okay. So
it comes to the launch day. Monkey's sat in there. Everyone's ready. Bananas are stocked up and all the rest of it. They go, right, hit the green button. right, and the rocket goes off and what have you.
No, they would not make the monkey launch the rocket. Carl, so, you are living in a cartoon world.
So the rocket goes off, right?
This is absolute bollocks!
It's all going well.
No way a monkey launched a rocket. There's no way a monkey launched a rocket,
so
you idiot.
It's all going on, so they go and hit the left button and it's, it goes
the left button! Right, so, well-known spacecraft command. This is Houston, hit the left button. Oh, brilliant. This is what happened in Apollo 13. Hit the left button.
So it goes left. Yeah, it goes left.
So it goes left. It's going away.
No, the moon. So
It goes for the moon. Everything's going well. Right. They get up there. It does whatever it does. Hit reverse. It comes back. So then,
you are brain dead. So you're one of the most stupid people. That I would rather have the monkey drive me home than you.
So the thing is, so it lands back. It does a good job and everything. It gets out. And this is where it turns a bit sad, because after it's done that mission, right? Because it happened and it was all safe and everything, the next one would have been to send man.
Right.
So the monkey enjoyed it and it was like, well, I want to do it again. Right? But they were like...
So how did they know that? How did they know?
Just the way it looked and what have you. Like,
fuck off! Just the way it looked! So, you are a maniac.
So the thing is, though, right, so after it had done that, it was on such a high, right? Yeah. It could never get that high again. There was nothing that it could do.
Went on tour,
didn't it? It sort of ended up killing itself. Because it could never get that buzz that it got.
Right, that was absolute bollocks. None of that is true, except they sent a monkey into space. And I'll check that. Absolute drivel.
So in your mind, it committed suicide. Yeah, it went on a crazy bender of drinking drugs and women. And
like then, it does happen, you know about it.
Found in a motel room.
I met Derek Okora the other week.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
And who's he? Which one's he? Is he a medium? He can contact the dead, is that right?
He just chats to him and that, passes messages on.
Nicely.
So I said, tell us something a bit weird and that. So he said, what do you want to know? I said, just something weird. So he goes, all right then. He said, here's one for you, right? And he said, there's this pub out in the country. And he said, there's this mug. Do you know those old mugs that they have? Where they used to like leave their own cup knocking
like
down.
Oh, yeah.
Tankard thing. Yeah. So there was one of them mugs in there, right? And everybody...
Let's use tankard if we just have it.
Tankard, yeah.
Because you're the only mug in this story. Right? Not leaving it all.
High five. Great.
So this tankard's knocking about, right? And everyone who's running the pub keeps going, oh, I wish they'd stop leaving this tankard about, right? Mm. And they pick it up.
It must be a pain. Having a tiny, small tankard in a pub. That must be a real grind.
So every time they sort of picked it up and went, we'll have to wash that, and they popped it on a different sideboard. Next thing you know, that person who's touched it died, right?
Sure. So
they must have been getting through bar staff.
So they kept getting a new staff, and they went, oh, what's the connection here?
Right? What's the connection here?
Oh, God.
So they get a vicar in.
Of course they do.
And they go, look, there's a lot of weird stuff going on here. This tankard, every time someone touches it, they die. So he said, leave it with me. He gets his special water out and what have you. He comes round, does a little prayer, sprinkles it. He goes, right, not a problem, don't worry about it. He picks it up, chucks it in the bin. Guess what?
What?
Dies in a crash on the way. Because he picked it up.
Well, but Carl, you're telling me this like it's fact, and I meant to go, that's amazing.
Derek Okora, he told me.
Carl, I have no opinion of that story, other than I'm pretty sure there was absolutely no connection between touching the tankard and him dying. That's all I'm sure
of. It's not just him, though, is it?
I'm not going to even contest the chain of events. All I'm saying is there is no connection. There is no connection possible, because I believe in logic and the laws of the universe.
Yeah, but what I mean, you never pick up a vibe of... I've got a mate, right, who's living in this big stately home, right, and he's living in there now. He pays £100 a month. There's about 80 rooms.
Gee.
And it's this big stately house, might be. And I went down there. He said, oh, come down, have a look, right? And from outside, you go, oh, this is brilliant. It's like something out of, you know, like The Man of Born or something. You go, this is impressive. But then when you get in, it's like, it's a wreck. And we go in, and all the floors are like a wreck and rotten and stuff. And I looked at the wall, and it was like a little piece of paper stuck on the wall, ooh, right? And I said, what's this here? So I wandered over, right? Got right up close to it, and somebody had wrote it.
Somebody had wrote it?
Oh.
Somebody had wrote it.
There's a little sign there, right? And I go up to it, and it says, flies, right? With an arrow. Flies, like, flies this way, yep, right? I think that's a bit weird. So I follow the arrow, right? Which goes to this corner where there's a shelf. About 3,000 dead flies on it.
Oh, my God.
Condom stuck on the top. That's weird, isn't it?
That is weird.
That is weird, right? So I'm looking at that, and there's loads of stuff on the floor and that bit of paper. Picked up this bit of paper, right? And it had, like, in biro and that. It looked really old, like it'd been there years. And it had, something like, need nappies, dummy, right? Blankets, blah, blah, all this, like, old stuff for, like... And I turned it over, right? And it said, none of this now needed, baby dead.
Right.
Now, that's weird, isn't it? Now, that's what I'm talking about when you get a bad vibe. You go, that's who's been in here.
It's bad vibe. It's just based on the fact that
your mate's in charge.
Yeah, that's terrifying. I mean, yeah. So it's like saying, "Are we scared of the dark?" Yes, I understand why people are scared of the dark. I'm a little bit scared of the dark. You're walking along
because you don't know what's in it.
Yeah, you don't know what's in the darkness. That's why people get nervous. It doesn't mean you have to make the leap then that you've got some paranormal sense. Oh my God, I'm Karl Pilkington. And hang on, just like Derek Okora, I have sensed something strange and evil in this room. Wait a minute, there's some flies in a condom. I was right all along.
That is weird.
Flies in a Johnny equals madness.
The flies in the condom was weird.
It's
now.
Weird.
But the note. Yeah. I just think of his face when he saw that. I mean, my torchlight. He must have been terrified.
It's a bit odd, isn't it?
Few years, Ricky Gervais, Stephen Merchant, and Karl Pilkington have been meeting regularly for a series of pointless conversations. Okay. This is one of them.
Testing.
Is that right? Hello, and welcome to the Ricky Gervais Show. With me, Ricky Gervais, Stephen Merchant.
Hello.
And the little round-headed buffoon, that is Karl Pilkington.
All right.
Now, you probably know me from such works as The Office and Extras, Stephen being my co-writer and co-director on those things. For those people who are not so aware of Karl Pilkington, he was our producer, sort of given to us when we first started on XFM. You're thinking, well, why are we doing a podcast? It's because I'd like to be in a room with Karl Pilkington. Mm. You know, like some people go and help sort of chimps.
Do they?
Yeah.
Well, they go to the you know, the jungles and things.
And help out little sort of endangered
species. Dying Fossey or whatever.
Exactly.
You're very much a dying Fossey of the Manchester scene.
Of the little bald Manc world. And Karl Pilkington is an ongoing experiment for me, because I've seen him blossom from an idiot into an imbecile. And I want to see it through. Look at the way he's looking at us. Look at that. He's got a perfectly round head. And that's why I'm doing this podcast. Karl, what do you think about all this?
We are living in that sort of era now, aren't we? Like, you need to... Yeah, I listen to stuff on demand when you want it and stuff.
I know, yeah. You're not a fan of the iPod in general, are you? Or any of the MP3 things, you're concerned?
I'm warming to it, but...
This is what's amazing about Karl. Even though he's talking about things like MP3 players, computers, iPods, he sounds like he was found in a glacier and thawed out. Yeah, do you know what I mean? Yeah. He sort of taught to speak.
We're a couple of high school guys who found him, and we're trying to ingratiate him in the gang, trying to pass him off as someone from the modern day.
But my thing with iPods is, now, do we need them? Do you know what I mean? We're living in that era now where we have invented most of the stuff that we need, and now we're just messing about.
They said that in 1900. Someone actually said everything that's to be invented has already been invented. They said that in 1900. And how wrong were they?
No, but what came out? At what point? What was invented in that year where they went, right, that's it now?
The 20th century. Think what happened in the 20th century.
Go on.
Well, planes.
Yeah, but is that a good thing? Planes and that. Do you need a plane, really? Wouldn't it have been better if we all stuck where we should be instead of travelling about?
War.
Why? Well, look, war's happening, isn't it? Because everyone's saying, well, now we can fly, we'll go over there.
So there were no wars prior to the invention of the aeroplane?
Not like there is today.
Right.
But what I'm saying is, the world's got smaller on it, everyone's saying that, right? Yeah. You know, the way I was saying to you the other day, you know, we now go to places where we shouldn't go. People go on holiday to places where you've got to have an injection before you go there.
Yeah.
Forget it then. That's a warning. Don't
worry.
Well,
I'm with you on that. I don't want to enter a country where I have to have an injection to stop me from dying while I'm in that country. Right, I totally agree with you on that.
So what happened is, so they invented the plane and it's like, oh, let's go on holiday. And then they go, oh, they die now. Oh, well, you've got to invent something. Let's invent an injection. And then it's like, right, well, what else do we need to go to that place? It's a lot of faffing. So what I'm saying is...
Is that a place? A lot of faffing?
What I'm saying is, you know, Steve's travelled more than I have. You've been to, like, dangerous places.
I've been to places where you need injections, yeah.
Yeah, but why?
Because it's fascinating, isn't it? You know, do you not believe in the idea of travel broadens the mind? You know, it makes you experience other ways of life, other ways of thinking. It just enriches you as a human being. That's the whole reason people go travelling.
Well, since the invention of the telly, you don't have to go that far to see
absolutely
it.
Right.
So there you go, then. The telly was the 20th century, wasn't it?
Yeah, it's pretty good.
So where would you stop, then? You'd stop making stuff now? Stop inventing stuff right now?
If we're going to invent something, right, forget, like, the traditional way of people having kids, right? The way they, you know, have it away and that. You know,
what do you mean?
No, you know, like, the way that, you know, we have kids and stuff. If it'd be good, if what happened was to control it, is if man and woman... Right, they sort of be born and that they enjoy their life. They learn a lot. They live to be about 78, I think, by that point.
Yeah,
no. But by 78, I reckon you've sort of got to that point where you go, do you know what? I've done everything I'm going to do. If you haven't bungee jumped by the time you're 78, you're not going to do it. You know what I mean? So it's kind of like
your hips come off.
You've done it all now.
Yeah.
And then you die, right? So say if everyone had that, they live to be 78.
Mm.
But then just as you die, you have a little baby inside you, and as you die, your life carries on.
Sorry,
how is this happening?
Sorry, are you mental?
No, but don't you think...
I mean, what? I've never heard such drivel.
You're saying that, but if Newton said it, you'd go, interesting. That's what annoys me.
I know he's Karl, he never would. He'd never say it, that's the point.
I don't understand what you're talking about there. What, how was it? How is there a little baby in a 78-year-old?
No, what I'm saying is it's like an apple, where the apple grows and it's got its little baby pips in it, and the apple goes and the seeds are planted and a new one's born.
That's what happens.
But that is what reproduction is.
Yeah, but I'm saying babies aren't being born left, right and centre. It's controlled so that as someone dies... Someone's born.
But Karl, stop. Whose responsibility is this?
If you don't want to do it, we won't do it. But
is it supposed to be nature? Is nature got to develop humans so that we act that way? We live that way? Or is this a scientific experiment?
He said to you then, he said, if you don't want to do it, we don't need to do it. Like, if you were up for it, we're sorted out. Yeah. We can do that.
We'll have a whip round. So we can do the research.
I just think, at the end of the day, we've got to do something. And is anyone keeping an eye on this and looking at what we can do next to control the population thing? It does my head in that I've got to live in London for work and what have you. And there's loads of people here. And, you know, forget going out on a Saturday night, it's too busy. and you can't move, and they keep... I mean, what annoys me about London...
So
is,
your solution is that 78-year-old women have little babies inside them, and as they slip away into death, the little babies... And how is that baby then raised?
Who looks after the baby? Because it's a pretty good system, having a baby while you're young enough to look after that baby and make sure it lives to, you know, reproductive age itself.
I mean, that system's been working for years.
Nature sort of sorted it out. Natural selection and evolution sort of makes that a good model.
But wait a minute, nature. Pop that on hold, because Karl Pilkington's got an idea.
Yeah.
That's what it was, just an idea.
Yeah, well, it was nonsense. But thank you for it.
The worst yeah. I mean, it was the ramblings of someone you'd find by themselves in a hospital eating flies.
This is the sort of thing you find when if they find maybe a pamphlet or a booklet written by a psychopath. You know, someone just before they went on a rampage and then turned the gun on themselves. They go through their possessions and they find a book and it's got weird drawings, women with knives in their face, and this kind of garbage.
In fact, I saw a similar sort of theory written out on a wall, but it was written in shit.
Exactly. Yeah.
No, all I'm saying is, I think it's, you know, when people die normally, everyone's fed up about it, aren't they, and a bit down. But if when you pass away, you go, oh, we're going to miss Gladys or whatever, but then there's this new life brought in, it's almost like a bad news.
But you're talking about it like someone could pick this idea up and run with it. Like, you've given them enough information to do it. How is this possible? Where does she get the baby from? Why does it grow? Why grow it in Gladys's belly? Why not have it in a drawer? Ready to go, just add water. I mean...
Who looks after son of Gladys?
There is no theory here. It's the ramblings of a madman.
What I'm saying is, though, the body's always changing, isn't it? From caveman to now, or whatever.
It's changing. Some cases.
And they're always finding out more and more. Like, I read the other day about how they're saying, do you know, like they say, people have six senses?
Yeah.
There's loads more than that. Right, and there's this one.
I was like, show me that you've got one.
No, right, and there's this one that's knocking about.
Go on.
That, what it is, say if I'm in a pub, right, and I'm just doing a crossword or whatever.
Unlikely, but go on.
And there's some woman who's walked in, right, and she's staring at me.
Yeah.
I know she's looking at me, and I look up and I look around, she's looking at me. Right. And they're saying that's a new sense that they found out from, like, you know, doing tests and what have you.
Yeah, it's rubbish.
And they're saying that's been around since like man and dinosaur was knocking about.
They've stopped.
No, they've explained it.
I think it's safe to assume that, you know, that with your perfectly round head, people are always stopping.
No, but they explained it.
You just know that they're probably going to be someone there.
They said it's from the time when, like, caveman was, like, wandering about and he'd go, hang on a minute. And he looked around, there's a dinosaur there or whatever, and he'd
right,
leg it.
This is nonsense. I hate when people use the term when caveman was wandering around. Caveman and dinosaurs, oh, they used to live together, yeah. Oh, that's the same era. Yeah. What have you been watching? Raquel Welsh.
What do you mean?
Well, what do you mean caveman wandering, knocking around with a dinosaur?
You know, the Flintstones is only partly based on fact. Dinosaurs and man did not coexist. The dinosaurs had long gone before man arrived. Extinct, kaput. You don't believe us?
Well, you don't believe because you've seen...
Because you saw that film where they took pictures of lizards and magnified them and put them next to men in films so they looked like they were fighting.
Yeah.
No, but why can't that have happened?
What is the film with Raquel Welsh? A Million Years BC.
A Million Years BC or something.
A Million Years BC. Brilliant.
Yeah.
No, but...
She had a sort of woolly mammoth bikini. Fact.
But why wasn't the dinosaurs back then just like how we have dogs now, in a way?
He's watching the Flintstones. He's thinking of the Flintstones. Yeah, that's what he's thinking.
When he puts out the saber-toothed tiger...
Yeah, and then and he misses his concrete in a pelican.
I just think that there must have been a crossover point.
Why? Why do you say that? Why do you think there must have been?
There must have been.
Because if nothing was knocking about at any point, how did anything carry on?
I know. Exactly. Why didn't Hitler meet Nero? It's weird. There must have been a crossover. They must have met somewhere. They must have met at a...